Welcome, everybody. It is my great pleasure to introduce today Professor Fantin, who comes from Italy. She is since 2016 a full professor of general and applied hygiene at the University of Bologna. She has a degree in medicine and surgery, a specialization in pediatrics, also immunological and allergic diseases, and also pediatric neuropsychiatry. And she's been doing a lot of health services research during the past years. And her research activity is in particularly on the study of organizational model for health services and systems for monitoring and evaluating the quality of care and overall the performance of health organizations to support the decisions of policymakers, managers, healthcare professionals, and patients. And during the pandemic, she addressed preparedness and response, excess mortality, and non-pharmaceutical interventions to reduce the impact of the pandemic. As you know, Italy has been very, very heavily touched by the pandemic. And another line of her research activity focuses on the safety of vaccines and the use of vaccines in different age groups. So quite a broad range of activities, and
Because I am old.
it's a great pleasure to welcome you on the floor. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Muriel, for this nice presentation. Thank you to everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here and to share with you some ideas and with Italian case studies about healthcare quality assessment with a specific focus on healthcare pathways. I will draw your attention on this paper written by a group of colleagues in Pisa, Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna di Pisa. I have been collaborating with them for more than 10 years. And the idea is to go to a new generation of performance and measurement systems in healthcare with a focus on value creation approaches and adopting a patient-centered perspective. The key points in this paper is that we went through a transition from a focus on budgetary control to a new second phase integrated performance measurement system. And we are still there, but we already have a third, more recent phase, which link key performance indicators to strategy. So it's important in this new or old ways to evaluate performance and the quality in healthcare services for value creation to adopt a network perspective and emphasize the creation of healthcare pathway. What we have there is a big fragmentation among professional institutions. So it's important to create a network, to create a healthcare pathway, and to find the way to measure, monitoring their implementation, the quality of care, and value added. So we go to healthcare pathways. So what are they? Complex intervention involving individuals, interfaces. They have some active ingredients, evidence-based key intervention, step-by-step implementation by professional teams involved in the process, and the importance of monitoring and assessing pathway performance. And we have to keep in mind strongly that it's difficult to implement healthcare pathway, and the success depends also on context, different local context, the type of intervention, and also on individuals, professionals involved. And we have also to keep in mind that is fundamental to monitoring the implementation and make a quality assessment and to create process outcome indicators just to know if the pathways are functioning and if we get better outcomes for the patients. And we also to keep in mind that, as I already said, that contextual variables are very, very important. And to know if we implement or not, beside, as I will show, the health outcomes, which make the quality and the value added, we have to measure if we are really achieving coordination, networking, which are the core business of this healthcare pathways across professionals and facilities. And this is the way to provide the information on why and how healthcare pathway works. Which evidence, what evidence do we have? Going back to 2010, there is a Cochrane review, many studies, not too many, and the conclusion of this review was that hospital pathways, but we are speaking about hospital, all the research was confined in acute hospital at the beginning. Hospital pathways are associated with fewer intra-hospital complications and to better clinical documentation without increasing length of stay or cost. So at the same cost without increasing for the new implementation, but there was now significant evidence on hard clinical significant outcomes as reduced mortalities and readmission. After that, there is a nice paper by Van Acht and Overwright. They discussed if the Cochrane review is the best way to have evidence of this type of intervention. They say we have to think new ways to gather evidence, and we have to keep in mind that we have to define exactly what we are talking about. It's much more difficult than define therapeutic intervention and whether the study methods are appropriate. And whether, and this is a big problem, we can properly define the outcomes that we want to measure to speak about effectiveness and efficiency. There is another body of evidence about the group of Varak in Lovanio. They are very active there on these topics, and they are linked to colleagues of mine in Italy, University of Piemonte Orientale. And they wrote the papers saying that what we have to measure if, and the outcomes that they are measuring is the process there. If healthcare pathways enhance team working, and they demonstrate that they did in a hospital. I want to point out that we are still speaking about in a hospital pathways. And also, they find out that using a care process self-evaluation tool with different professionals through many hospitals, that healthcare pathways can support better organized, more efficient care processes. So they use the processes as outcomes of the evaluation, but then the same groups went further and they said that also the health outcomes, and they demonstrated this for patients with stroke and for patients with COPD, and miglioramento of the quality of care in terms of 30 days, 7 days, 30 days mortality, and also in terms of readmission. So a few considerations about this evidence. We have evidence from the literature that suggests that healthcare pathway help improve adherence to guidelines, organization and coordination of processes of care, team working, better patient health outcomes in some way, and cost reduction. But this evidence these pieces of evidence are still weak, and we may find inconsistency in outcome measure and intervention. And most of this evidence is about the short-term outcomes from acute condition treated in a hospital setting. And we don't have much external validity. As I said before, we have to keep in mind that this healthcare pathway must be contextualized and have to take into account the different ingredients that we have in the different contexts. So another important lesson is that we have to evaluate to find the way to standardize in some ways this evaluation. But the lesson is that each system should arrange, monitor, and assess its own pathway, keeping into account a number of context-specific features that have a critical impact on the success of the pathway. And then, with these premises, I go to our case studies, referred to the Emilia-Romagna region where I come from. I am from Bologna, and the region we can see where it's located in the long and narrow country, Italy, where we have 21 regions. We have a national health system which gives us the principles. But each region is autonomous in the organizational parts, so we may have differences. And inside the same region, we have local health authorities that decline the programs from the national and regional level locally. And so I will present examples from the local health authority of Bologna, which is a huge one, a metropolitan area. I think I look at the figures about the same population than Canton Vaud, 8,063 inhabitants, and then another huge local health authority, Romagna, which is coming from the merging of previous four local health authorities, which is more now than 1 million inhabitants. So let me say the two of them, two quarters of the entire population of the region, which is 4.5 million inhabitants. I think that is half the Switzerland Federation. So we are speaking about many inhabitants. So the focus is on a heart failure, an acute chronic condition, which is prevalent and not so much as diabetes, a chronic condition, which is 10 times this prevalence, but is an important condition with a high mortality and a utilization of services, and is becoming even more prevalent with the aging population, a condition with a poor prognosis. And this is much important, very important to take care and to have coordinate care and to prevent mortality and assessing to hospitals. So assessing to hospital is not bad things per se if you give there the right treatment and you prevent mortality. But the point is that we speak about avoidable hospitalization because for this type of condition, if we have good services, well coordinated outside the hospital and between a hospital and primary care sector, you may avoid hospitalization. So this avoidable hospitalization for me is a tricky concept. Also in an OECD set of indicators, as they speak about avoidable hospitalization for health failure. I think avoidable if you have the right service in the right place and if you take care of the patient. These are some figures for heart failure in Europe, Western country. These are figures from Italy. This is a report, a national report on outcomes at the hospital level, which is computed by the Ministry of Health, taking all the data from hospital abstract form, which are periodically transmitted to the center, linked with the mortality registry. And this is in Italy in the different year overall, the letality of heart failure during the hospitalization, 30-day mortality, so not during the incident admission, but at the 30 days is increasing. Probably the figures are the ones we can see in the literature is more than 10%. And it's increasing. These are not adjusted probably for the increasing, well, 2020 is strange year with the COVID condition, probably less care outside the hospital. So we don't know really the determinants, but we can see that mortality is increasing. And these are comparison with the median national value in the same report. There is the reference you can assess and go through all the different charts. And this is the adjusted mortality for several conditions. And these are the position of the hospital of the Emilia-Romagna region. So most of them don't do differently from the median. Yes, I think that most of them don't do. This is better results, two better results. A small hospital we are working with now, Ospedale Ceccarini Riccione in Emilia Romagna, will look after. And readmission, the same figures than in the literature for Italian hospitals. And in 2020, probably less people went to the hospital because less accessibility, fear to be infected with SARS-CoV-2. And these are the median value of the hospitals of Emilia-Romagna region, adjusted, compared with the national mean. And now I want to discuss the implementation starting more than 10 years ago of a healthcare pathway for health failure in the local health authority of Bologna. And the pathway took care of the different phases, access to emergency care, hospital admission and discharge, what was going on during the acute phase and the discharge and the outpatient care. And here are all the professionals involved in the pathway in the hospital and outside the hospital. And the point is, it's really important to have integration and coordination among professionals inside the hospital and among hospitals and primary care professionals with the different professionals involved, GPs, nurses, cardiologists, and other specialists. physical therapists and social workers outside the hospital. So the key intervention to manage with a patient with a heart failure in a hospital and primary care are intended to improve access to care, cooperation between professionals, working acute and ambulatory setting. This is a big problem. To have a follow-up visit, early follow-up visit and going on visit, enhance therapeutic reconciliations. Many of these patients have a lot of medication and to facilitate medication adherence, have involvement of ambulatory care nurses. So this is something we are discussing a lot, primary care nurses, nurses involved in a chronic condition in the hospital and outside the hospital, case management and whatever, and how to give patient and all caregiver education about medication adherence and healthy lifestyle. To prevent disease worsening. And a key question in the implementation of this heart failure clinical pathway was the role of a cardiologist. So we worked a lot in the last 10 years with the local health authorities, and we tried to find out what was going on. And here I try to summarize four papers we published on this subject, starting from 2015 to 2019, just before the pandemic came and modified all the way we had to treat chronic patients, at least for 2020 and 2021. So the methodology is more or less the same with some differences in the four papers. We carried out observational retrospective cohort study with a SCARE administrative databases linked with some local health authority databases. And we try to analyze the association between determinants and processes and outcomes. And we try, as we are in an observational setting, to adjust as much as we could. And I will show a paper on this stuff for potential confounders using multivariable regression analysis. The first study, just to know where I am, I am in Switzerland. I know I have to be very precise with the time, and I am anxious for this. Study one. We try to evaluate the impact of different organizational factors on the outcome, readmission for health failure patients. The study year was 2010, and we had a follow-up for 1 year after with individual data after hospital discharge. And the exposure variables were implementation in primary care units, which are we call nuclei di cure primarie, something we have in Emilia-Romagna now. We try to have in Italy with different names, but Emilia-Romagna started with this compulsory, I would say, units where GPs work with nurses. GPs who may be organized in solo or group practices. So we had two exposure. So the implementation, or what they said they had implemented as a health failure health care pathway in the primary care unit, and we tried also to disentangle the role of GPs organizational arrangement, and the outcome used were unplanned hospital readmission for health failure and for hospital readmission for any reason. Let's go to the results. There are all the table with the numbers, but after adjusting for age, sex, and significant patient characteristic, the organization of health failure care pathway in the primary care unit was associated with the lower risk of the hospital readmission for heart failure in all the time frame considered. But the GP's organizational arrangements solo versus group practice was unrelated to the outcome. So a monoprofessional arrangement didn't make the work to ameliorate this outcome in this context. Study two. So we had a big quarrel with the professionals. They said you don't adjust in the right way, you take information only from administrative databases, and we link all the hospital abstract chart form, pharmaceutical databases. We went 3 years before the index hospitalization to find comorbidities, but they said that they missed the point because we didn't have important severity clinical variables. So we did a big work with a lot of young researchers going through more than 1,000 clinical records to pick up clinical variables. So we try to find risk adjustment models with the hospital abstract form information, demographic comorbidities from the hospital abstract form and length of stay. And then we try to add after a long work of definition of which information we are taking from the clinical records, not electronic clinical record, not yet there. And so through charts and all these variables. Just to tell you the story, we found that some, not all of them, clinical variables enhance the discrimination of the model to predict 30-day mortality, but not 30-day readmission. But what happened is that the model was more performant, but when we adjusted the differences in the different hospital performance, because they said that we were unfair, not confounding what they are with the clinical variables. So the model is better, but it doesn't worthwhile for adjusting. We don't add much in the confounding we found there. And then study three. We try to respond to the big question, the role of cardiologist care, because there is a lot of evidence that we have a better care with the cardiologist instead of internal medical doctors or general doctors, both in the inpatient and the outpatient settings. And so for the year 2015, with a 6 months follow-up after discharge, we try to find out if the ward of discharge cardiology versus other ward and the outpatient cardiology visit during the follow-up make the difference in processes and outcomes intervention. And the story is a little bit complicated. Is a linked story. We found that only 44, no, 24% of the patients during the acute hospital stay were seen. Excuse me, only 12.8%. Patients were in the cardiology ward, the other mostly were in internal medicine ward, and only 24 of them were seen by cardiologists during the follow-up visit, and which is a very scanty number, only 8.8% were formally included in the multidisciplinary as a failure as care pathway, because we had a database at the local health authority where we could find patients officially enrolled with their informed consent in the pathway. So not many of the patients during the acute hospital stay and during the outpatient follow-up were treated by cardiologists. And what we found out, we confirmed it was there in the literature, but was important for our professional. Patient discharged from cardiology were seen more frequently by a cardiologist during follow-up, as well as those included in the failure health care pathway. And patients seen by a cardiologist, either in cardiology ward or in outpatient services, were more adherent to evidence-based medication within 6 months after hospital discharge. And this is the key point, the mediators of the relationship between cardiological care. And we didn't formally made a mediation analysis, but it came out pretty well that medication adherence is linked to reduced mortality and reduced admission at the different level of time. So cardiological care is an important part, directly involvement, or as we like to say, having the cardiologist as a consultant specialist during the acute hospital care, and more importantly, during the primary health care follow-up. This is another paper. Which says the same thing, but we try to explore with a geolocalization method, very complicated, if the availability and accessibility to healthcare services were a mediation or an important factor for the good health outcomes. So it was a problem on the offer side, and we try to find out the distance driving time from the homes of patient discharged for an heart failure at different facilities where cardiological patients were treated, GPs and whatever. And we found that no significant association of travel times with the study outcomes were observed because we have plenty offer. We have probably too many services and also overlapping. So it was not a problem of availability of structure. Everyone could drive in a very short time to a facility where they can be followed up for a heart failure. But at the same time, we confirmed what we said 6 years before. So new cohorts that confirmed that the cardiology scale, it was not an artifact, it was still there, was associated with less readmission and less emergency department visits. And the outpatient cardiologist care this time was directly associated with reduced mortalities. And again, patients who were in the heart failure pathway were more adherent to evidence-based medication. So the new cohorts confirmed the main result we obtained 6 years before. So I think this is a robust result, at least for the context where we implemented all this healthcare pathway. So in summary, prescribing and supporting patients with heart failure to take their medicine correctly, what they try to do involving them in the pathway with nurses, following them, calling by phone, visiting at home, is a fundamental process of care that reduces mortality and hospital readmission. Cardiologist care is an important key point to foster adherence to medication. We didn't disentangle the role of nurses and cardiologist care, but cardiologist care came out as the most important thing to have adherence to medication, probably less overlapping of drugs, the most recent, whatever. So the specialist probably and also more authority prescribing drugs. And so important point is to have a smooth follow-up and have a cardiology visit after discharge, at least to have the cardiologist as consultant to the GPs, to the nurses, and to have this, the goal is to have more integrated care. And in this paper, see, we didn't, as VanACT did for other in-hospital healthcare pathways, we didn't directly measure teamwork and coordination, but we imagined that behind this result, there is promoted by the health failure pathway, more integrated care. And then in the last few minutes, I want to present you a new case study, which is an ongoing one. I just have the idea what we are trying to do. We are supporting the local health authority of Romania, the managers there, with our data collection and trying to draw on information what's going on and how to rearrange the services after the pandemic. Lesson learned is so important to have a coordination between the hospital level, the primary care level, and going back to documents published before, that we have to take into account that there is a changing role also in the hospital, not an important rearrangement in primary healthcare setting. But it's important to rearrange the hospital and to have the walls of the hospital more permeable and create a connection with primary healthcare sector. So the project we are working with, we probably may tell the end of the story in the next month if we will have the opportunity, because there are a lot of obstacles from the professional side. The specialist, the culture of the cardiologist, and what they want to achieve there is to modify the cardiological care organization, having a cardiologist in a sort of unique role across hospital and primary care sector, moving around. And so it's something that they want to achieve, the management, but I don't know. And again, we contributed to gather this information. The most frequent causes of acute hospital admission to internal medicine cardiology wards in the 10 hospitals of the local health authority of Romania for specialized hospital and other district hospital is heart failure, given the whole the population followed by ischemic heart disease. And again, we confirm the figures. 20% of the heart failure discharged patients are readmitted to hospital within 30 days. And another big problem that they are trying to resolve there, long waiting time for cardiological outpatient visits. So we say that we need the cardiological visits, it's a follow-up, we need the cardiologist consultant, but the systems are separate and different way to book the visits and long waiting list. So the idea is they have also there, as in the Bologna local health authority, a health failure pathway, but it doesn't work completely for this to solve this problem, the waiting list to reduce hospital admission. So the problem are still there. So the further step they want to take there is to create a new cardiology service beyond the hospital boundaries. So they want to reorganize cardiological function in the hospital, creating a progressive care organization, high, medium, low care intensity with the cardiologist as a consultant in intensive care and medium care intensity. In the different level of care in the hospital, have a multidisciplinary and multiprofessional integration, cardiologist, internal medicine doctors, specialized nurses, and then have a migration of cardiologists from the hospital to the primary care level to work as a consultant and to favor the fast tracks for patient with at the outpatient level for patient with heart failure, for example. Because if something wrong and the nurses say, okay, you are worsening your condition, but if you have to wait for the specialist visit, mostly they go to the emergency department. That's why we have such a big numbers of patients going back several times at the revolving door, old patient, and a lot of heart failure. So they want to have more connected services and have a fast track there to do the first diagnostic exam, the first prescription, and leave the most acute and the severe patient to go to the hospital. So they want to settle down a new cardiology service, bringing cardiology in community, which is a very tough work. And cardiologists are resisting there. So we are providing numbers, and the general director say this is a way of doing. He is contracting with the local political power, but we are just in the middle of this organization. I want just to tell you because it's an evolution of heart failure pathway. So going back to the beginning, to play the patient music, as Sabina Nuti says, I think we have to change the organizational models and find the way to monitor and to evaluate if we have better outcomes. If we implement what we say we are implementing, and if we have better outcomes at the population level, so to create value for the patient, for the population.
Thank you very much. So, is there questions here? What you can say, Marianike?
Methodological question, but we may discuss this afternoon. One general question about digital technology framework. Is there any room for telemedicine or remote surveillance? Because those are elderly patients, and they can be surveyed at home using digital technologies. So is there any devices or
Now, yes, there are new programs specifically after the pandemic waves, because people, professionals said we can do the work, we need to visit the patient, but as soon as the SARS-CoV-2 spread around, many of them find the way to reach the patient and to have a long distance consultation. And now there are experimental programs going on with the foundings to use a telemedicine device, but it's a huge field, so we have to distinguish it. And in some works, they are trying to do there. I think that one of the problems is to have nice platform, easy to use, and to take into account the digital divide with the old people. If they don't have skilled caregivers, they can do the job. So this is one of the problems. Phone calls is okay, but if you want other telemonitoring, other things, you need friendly to use instruments.
Isabel? Thank you very much for this very interesting presentation. And so, if I understand well, this hardware has the transfers allow part of the services that are available and paid for all patients or the people residing in this region. Is that correct?
Yes, the services are free for payment because we have a national health system, and we, in theory, give everything to everyone, but the organizational ways may differ a lot. And there is the problem of different organizational models. So sometimes pathways are obstacles, pathways. And you can find the right care at the right moment in the right places. This is why we want to organize this pathway with more coordinated care and more continuity of care. And they are free of charge because if they don't go to the private sector and they pay out of pocket, all this care is supposed to be covered by the National Health Insurance.
Do you have an idea of the proportion of heart failure patients
Over.
into the, do you have an idea of the proportion of heart failure patients who participate in those pathways? And also, did this nice experience diffuse to other chronic diseases such as diabetes or COPD?
So they are healthcare pathway also for that. For diabetes is a long-standing one, but well. I think is to make a program and design a diagram, and another thing is to implement. So we have ideas of what's going on, and another point is that we pay the variable part of the salary of the GPs, achieving goals of diabetes patient controls. But this is an incentive system which fragments even more because they are paid if some percentage of their patients make the control for a HbA1 hemoglobin, or if they have a fundus oculi, which doesn't mean that they are seen in a multidisciplinary way and that they are inserted in the pathway. So honestly, I have to say that there is an old diabetic patient pathway, but the monitoring system is not so satisfying. And we have different incentives in the system, mostly for GPs. The care of diabetic patient is more demanded to the general practitioners. They need less specialists than the heart failure patients. And the incentive system is too much fragmented. That's one of the problems. I don't know if I answered it.
Maybe there was the first part of the question was, do you know what proportion of the heart failure patients are kind of across, you know, going
Okay,
through
in the
those?
local health authority of Bologna, as I showed you, they were followed up in different ways, but 10% were in the list of the local health authority because to get in formally into the health care pathway, you have to sign an informed consent. So 10%, which is not, I think that they are more, but what we officially have is 10% in the 19, in 2015, maybe some more now. I don't have fresh data.
Other questions? Yeah, Joachim.
Yeah, it was related to Isabel's question on how are you included in a heart failure pathway? Is it does that depend on the PCU or primary care unit you are in, or the hospital you're admitted, or is this just your choice with your doctor?
All what you said, we have a different anchor point. That's why we try to examine it. After a while, we were dealing with this heart failure pathway. What happened for the cardiological visit? Because we could monitor them from the administrative databases. And this is one piece of the pathway, just to be seen by a specialist shortly after the discharge and in the follow-up. But being in the pathway means much more than be seen by the cardiologist. So this is something what we try to use as a proxy, but we should go there and ask the patient as evidence also of people working together, because we don't really know which is the connection.
Yeah, I don't see any question on the chat, but Mauricio?
Yeah, thank you very much. That's really, really interesting. So I had a question maybe related to Joachim. So I think what I'm having trouble is that people get into this pathway not by random assignment, right? So it's
Yeah.
what is it that's driving people going into these pathways? And then you connect these to outcomes. And so you have this, like, as you said yourself, you have this sort of really big confounding by
Yes.
indications. And so I think it would be great to understand a little bit more what are the decision-making steps that lead to someone getting into this pathway and trying to do something to account for that, no? Because, for example, some of the correlations that you see there are clearly driven by selection to me.
Yes. It's true. We tried. I did explain all the
Exactly.
statistical work behind the multi-level analysis, a lot of confounders taken into account. I went to the end of the story, but that's true. And we can do a randomized trial. This is something which came from the regional level. The local health authority had to implement. So what we can do is see who is adopting, who not. Asking them if in the primary care unit they adopted, and we have to trust them. And we tried in one of these papers, I don't remember which one, try to control for primary care units variable in a multiple level analysis, the number of GPs, the way they were aggregated, the time they got the degree, the number of the patients in the practice, but nothing was important, but we took into account, and we can't have an experimental design. We tried also with another design, interrupt the time series. We did some exercise, very nice from a biostatistical point of view, but we didn't get the result till now. So, too few observations, confounding still there. So the slope didn't move nicely. So we didn't publish, we didn't present, probably not enough data.
So even if you have 80% more of the people which help when you go to the goal, these help in your pathways, and you use administrative data, you couldn't have a control group. That's in the pathways.
So we may have historical control, but well, is even more, is even dirtier than have an observational study, and we try to control for as many confounding factors as we can. So that's why I say that it's important to take into account also the context variables, and we try to put some of them there, but well, it's not enough. So we need more evidence, we need more reflection on how to monitor and how to evaluate. I, in my premise was that we have a lot of further research on this, and from a methodological point of view is very important. Probably the Cochrane review method doesn't make the work, but we have to find new methods. Yes, yes, that's what I am saying, and is I say my mantra in this part of my careers. But well, we are trying to do something, but it's not the perfect way, absolutely not.
And on my side, I had a question as well. How is it about advanced nursing care in your region?
It is a big struggle.
Does it exist?
Well, we have a legislation where the role of nurses modified, but they still can do medical activities, and the physician professional bodies are very much concerned on this. So they have a new role in the primary healthcare sector with chronic disease, but what you probably mean with advanced roles on a diagnostic and a therapeutic role, not yet.
To follow up, you know, those patients, whether they adhere to medication, you know, things that could be taken over by.
Yes, but they need the doctor if there is something wrong, and they need to modify the prescription and to have a diagnostic exam. They may have a basic diagnostic exam, but they need the doctor to interpret and. So this is something which is debating, because we don't have enough doctors now. We don't have also enough nurses, but what everyone is speaking about after the pandemic is task shifting and how to put new activities on the nurses. It is easier to have a nurse in 3 years instead of a doctor in 6 years. So we may enlarging the numbers of training the profession. We may have a bigger number for nurses in a shorter time, but we still don't know how to manage with this advanced little doctors. Doctors don't want the little doctors behind that.
Okay, so I see that we reached the time. So thank you very much again for.